those of you who are gardeners are familiar with Murphy's Law, I trust, of gardening. I am, for sure. When weeding, the best way to make sure that you are removing a weed and not a valuable plant is to pull on it. If it comes out of the ground easily, it's a real plant. It's that simple. If it's the a logical corollary to that, of course, is to distinguish flowers from weeds, do what I do, which is simply pull up everything. And then what grows back is a weed. So my garden is full of weeds. And that's why my house doesn't always look as good as yours, but such is life. Last week, we dealt with the parable of the sower and the seed. And we learned that different kinds of soil produce differing levels of results. But today, we are confronted with the question, what do we do with the weeds and the weeds in the garden? Because we know those who have ever tried to plant a flower garden or a vegetable garden or any kind of garden or even a lawn, certainly my experience is that the weeds will come. It's just a fact. And the question is, what do we do with that? And so as you heard read, I'm not going to repeat this parable, but it is in Matthew 13, and you might want to gaze upon that as we talk about it. Because it's important to emphasize and remember that the disciples asked, here's kind of one of the crunches of this parable, is that parable, disciples, they actually get to a point where they say, do you want us to pull the weeds up? And Jesus says, don't pull up the weeds, because whilst you pull up weeds, you may pull up good wheat as well. And so that's kind of a crunch line of that parable. If you take Jesus literally, this is a pretty scary parable. The weeds are going to be thrown onto a fire and they are going to be burned. Jesus isn't actually giving us a guide on growing good wheat, of course. He's talking about our human behavior. But one thing for sure in this scenario, you don't want to be a weed. Okay? That's pretty clear. Now, this next little example I say with positive affection. It is comes from the Roman Catholic tradition, and it was shared with me by a Roman Catholic priest. It's the story of the little girl, and she understands and is taught in the Roman Church is that when you turn 7, that is considered in their tradition the time of cognitive awareness where then you can partake of the Mass and you must go to regular confession. Why? Because when they are 7, they are accountable for their sins. That's the teaching of the Church. So this little 5-year-old girl was so impressed when she learned about this, is that when her older brother turned 7, she greeted him with this, "Happy birthday, Matthew. Now you can go to hell." See, there's always a positive side to this stuff. And I say that again with affection. There is, of course, the overall theme that jumps out at most of us, and that's the whole notion of judgment. And it is not a theme that many of us care for. Judgment is such a difficult theme. I confess I struggled with this sermon this week, seemingly forever. Let me share with you what goes through the mind of the preacher when he reads this and says, okay, what do I say to the people? Judgment is something none of us like, but are clearly guilty of it from time to time. Is that not true? There is a sermon there, and I'm saying, do I run with that rabbit down that rabbit hole? There's a sermon from the text right there. Or the consequences of judgment, of being judgmental in our attitudes, and what it does to others and what it does to us. Because many are guilty of judging themselves. Did you hear that? Judging themselves. And this is very destructive, and there's a whole sermon right there. Do I go there? Third thought, there is judgment that comes from God. Not judgment from you and me, but judgment that does come from God. There will be a day when we are called to account for the lives that we live, and we will have to stand before the throne of God. So it begs the question, what is the nature of that judgment? What is the nature of God? And there's a whole sermon there. What about justice? And then there's the theme about weeds. What are we to do with the weeds and the wheat? And it begs the question, and here's another sermon. How do you know with any confidence whether you're wheat or a weed? Do you know? Do you ask yourself that question internally as the preacher's going on, go, I don't know if I'm a weed or a wheat. Am I an innie or am I an out? Well, it's, what is that? It's all about belly buttons, right? You're either an innie or you're an out. Or if you're certain you are weak, how are you to live with the weeds? Especially as it appears that we are not called to do much weeding. What does that look like? There's another sermon. How are we to be discerning without being judgmental? Do you catch that distinction? That's tonight's sermon. So tonight at 5, I'm running with that one. Today, this morning, I want to go somewhere a little different. So I pray in the course of the week, and I say, God, what do you want us to hear from this text? And that's the task of a preacher, and I trust we take it pretty seriously. On the surface, there is certainly one thing that needs to be said about the parable. Make sure that you are not a weed. Because one day the weeds will be thrown into the fiery furnace. That's what the text says. We've got to deal with it. The weeds are all those who do evil. And then I pause and go, okay, let's define evil. It's a little disconcerting. All who do evil, where does God draw the line? Murderers? Certainly not murderers. I mean, that's not good. How about rapists? How about adulterers? How about if you just cheat on your income tax? Where does God draw the line about the good versus the bad? How good do you have to be to ensure that you are an innie as opposed to an outie? Are you with me on this? Do you see the problem? Because I certainly do. How good must we be? Well, what about those who ignore their neighbors or those in need? How about those who give only a pittance to God after God has been so generous to them? Where is the line drawn? Could it be that St. Paul is right? Romans 3:23. I've asked Derwin to put it on the screen. This is an important, pivotal piece of scripture. Paul builds the case in Romans. You read it in chapter 8. It gets built on, and it works on this truth. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. No, not one is good enough. And you must own that and get to that place yourself where you recognize that you fall short. And it is but by the glory and grace of God that we are in ease. Okay? That we are in the kingdom of God. If you reduce, as Christians do and mainline Anglicans are faulty of doing, if we keep reducing our Christianity to good boys and good girls, we're in real trouble. And it's an indication that we do not understand the depth of the gospel. It is the redemptive act of Christ on the cross. And when you can own that and recognize that you put your name in there, not just all, but all of us, and when we personalize it, then all of a sudden this communion starts to have a power and a significance in our lives. Because I do not want to stand before God dependent on my own virtue. That's a scary place to be. Let me give you something really important about God and his ways. God and the nature of his divine ways, when he is fully just, yet he is fully merciful. Okay, we're talking about God's judgment here. You're going to stand before the throne of God. Now know this. God is thoroughly just. Does that ring true to you? If so, please nod. He's a just God. That makes me feel good to know that God cares about justice. Not just us, but justice. Okay? But then he also is thoroughly merciful and compassionate. Do you believe that God is thoroughly merciful and compassionate? Nod if you agree with that. Please, some nods. Okay? The human mind, certainly my mind, unless you're more brilliant than I am, which is pretty possible, here's the point. These two points are diametrically opposed. You cannot be, in the human capacity, thoroughly just and yet also thoroughly merciful. It is a mystery. Sacramental. It is the that's why it's sacrament. It's not a symbol. It is a sacrament. It is a mystery. We enter into the place where justice and mercy kiss. The psalmist talks about that. And that the culture does not get. And I hope you get it. Because when you recognize that God holds this mystery in the cross, it's why we come into church with the cross. That's why we send the children out with the cross. It's all about the cross. It's why people cross themselves. It's because you recognize you do not need to stand before God and worry. Not because you're presumptuous. It's because of the cross. And that is the liberation news. That God in his judgment, now here's important, God's judgment is never, ever punitive. Punitive meaning you're wrong and you're going to spend days in jail for what you did wrong. That's punitive. Okay? You're wrong and you know you're wrong. Go to jail. God's judgment, and this is worth a two-hour lecture. That's why there's Bible studies here in this church. That's why there's study groups so we can unpack this stuff. When you stand before God, he is not punitive. He is restorative. It's about reconciliation. He is bringing all things to completion. That's the work of the cross. And we need to get a hold of that. That's a whole sermon, but I don't want to spend more time on it because it just deserves too much time. But that's why we should not judge and leave the weeding to God. Because he is the judge and he's the one who will actually be restorative. It is because we tend to move from a position of winners and losers, from sinners and saints, right and wrong, and God in the gospel of Jesus transcends all those categories altogether. Open your Bibles if you care to, or Derwin will put up just the precy, Romans chapter 8. Verse 1, it was read to you last week. He builds the whole case in chapters 1. I knew one guy who sat down, I think I've told you this, one guy who sat down, who was a non-believer. He sat down and he read Romans chapter 1. By the time he got to chapter 9, he converted. Okay, the argument is so brilliant. Okay, so when he goes to it, and he builds the case, and then Romans 8:1 says this, in the cross, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Isn't that just wonderful? That's why we say in the Lord's Prayer, now we are bold to say. Who are we bold to say anything to God? It is because of the cross of Jesus Christ that you can actually say, our Father. Jump to verse 14, 15 for me, please. And then it says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God, this was read to you this morning, are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. If I could emphasize the word, it's fear. I know so many people who live in fear. Walk around with a sense of being judged, and maybe you have been judged. That's not the Christian way. I deal with it daily. I often feel judged, whether I am or not. Bad taste just goes on inside. It's the human thing. But in Christ, this stuff is released. And there's a joy and a freedom. And if we can enter into it, then we go to God and we say, a spirit of adoption. The old rendition was a spirit of sonship. But we wanted to be inclusive because it's sons and daughters. But you're an heir to the kingdom of God. How many of you have children? Put up your hand. Fair number. Okay. Are your children... Would you ever reject your children? No. Even if they did something terribly wrong, you might weep. You might correct them, which isn't judging. That's discernment. we'll talk about that tonight. But okay, but here, do you see where we are with this? This is hugely important. This is the nature of how much God loves you and why we should not judge, because we don't have the full perspective. Oh, there is so much to say. Time doesn't allow me to do this. But I'll tell you how hard it is for us to not learn this point. I mean, I could preach on this literally for an hour. It's that important. Jump to Luke. Is it 13:51?
Nine.
Okay. Is it 9? Yeah, okay. There's Jesus. Days drew near to him. He was taken up to go to Jerusalem. He sent messengers ahead of him, and on their way, he entered the village of Samaritans. Samaritans are second-class citizens, right? And to make ready for him, but they did not receive him. So Jesus is walking through Samaria with his disciples, and the Samaritans go, "We don't like you, Jesus." And that gets the disciples of Jesus, the followers of Jesus, really upset. Toward Jerusalem, that's the holy city. When his disciples James and John saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire and come down from heaven and consume them?" But Jesus turned and rebuked them and said, "No." Okay, here's huge stuff. Jesus, keep that up, please. Jesus just told a parable about thou shalt not judge. And a few chapters later, I know I'm in Luke, but work with me. A few chapters later, in real life, in a non-parable, the disciples become judgmental because they know they're with Jesus. And that's what we can do. We know what's right. We're walking with the Lord. We see what's right. We see what's wrong with the world. And it breaks our heart. And we say, "How do they live like that? Why do they do that? Why don't they come to church? Why aren't they good people? Why don't they?" And we get upset. And we can become judgmental. "You want me to cast fire down on them?" And Jesus says, "No. Didn't I just tell you a parable about thou shalt not judge?" And in real life, here they are judging. I'm going to conclude with a quick story that I think, I always write too much. Do not judge. I can't find it. There it is. I'll leave you with this. And it's about you and me. And it's about our habits. Because we have brains and we become critical in our thinking, you need to exercise critical thinking. Here goes. A man and his wife go into a full-service gas station. And the gas jockey comes in and starts pumping the gas. And the man behind the wheel says, "Could you please clean the windows? My windows are dirty." And so the jockey goes and he cleans the best of his ability. And the man says, "For God's sake, man, clean the windows. I told you, there's smudges all through this thing. Redo your job." And so the jockey tries to do the right thing, gas guy, and he cleans the windows again. He's looking for smudges. Third time, he's, "My goodness, I've got to talk to your boss. You're pathetic. You don't know how to clean windows." His wife leans over, takes off his glasses, cleans them, puts them back on his face, and says, "Honey, you got a few smudges on there," and he looks and sees how clear the glass really is. What kind of glasses are we wearing, folks? That's the work of your spirituality. Is removing the glasses with all the stains so that we will walk humbly with our neighbor. God bless you as we walk in the kingdom of God. Judge not, lest ye be judged.